HH family, the prayer team here at New Hope really wants to be praying for you and your requests. And there's two ways to do that. After each and every single service, there's a prayer team in the back of the church that will pray for you and for your requests and your needs. Also, on Tuesday mornings at 7 a.m., a mass text is distributed to the whole church and asking for your prayer requests. So listen, if you're not signed up for a mass text, please do that. God loves you. We love you. We want to pray for you. And just be blessed. God bless you. Aloha.
Hey, sweetheart, what are we here to talk about today?
Youth ministry.
That's right, youth ministry. We're here to invite all you youngsters, all you youth to come join us every single second service on Sunday. We talk about life. We talk about Jesus, which is the main thing we talk about. We talk about you, issues, problems, everything. And we have a lot of fun doing it. Hey, parents, we want you to bring your children and let them come to the youth class. Encourage them to learn more about their Lord, learn more about life, and learn lessons that are going to bless them for their entire existence. So, we hope you guys come on in.
See you there. Good morning, everybody. All right, we can do better than that. Good morning, New Hope Lihue. All right, that's much better. Let's all stand as we get ready to worship and thank our Father on this beautiful 4th of July. Happy 4th of July. And Lord, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for the freedom we have in you. We thank you for the freedom of this country that we can come together and worship you and you alone, God. So would you come as we worship and lift up your name in Jesus' name. Amen. 1, 2, 3.
Blessed be your name. Thank you.
Bless his name. And I don't know if you noticed, but we have a different kind of vibe going on in, up here this morning. We have our awesome Uncle John and Derek and Uncle Connor joining us this morning. Would you welcome them and praise the Lord for their lives and for serving this morning with us? And you know, we do all this for him, for our Jesus, our God and Savior. And so this is not a performance. This is your time with your Lord to connect with him, to receive what he has for you, and to give him all that he deserves, all the honor, all the glory, all the praise, God, and you alone we worship this morning, Father. And sometimes we don't see the victory, but that doesn't mean it's not coming. So if you're in the fire this morning, and if you're looking, and you're waiting, know that God is God, and he's on the throne, and you're going to see your victory in Jesus' name. Amen.
When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war you wage is new. Oh, I'm not backing down from any giant. I know how this story ends. Yes, I know how this story ends. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. Sing it with us. We're gonna see a victory. We're gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Yes, we will. we trust you, Father. We surrender all to you this morning, Lord. Because there's power in your name. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. You sing. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. You sing. There is power. There is.
What a clap offering to our Lord Jesus Christ. Good morning, church. How you guys all doing today? Man, it is 4th of July. Happy Independence Day. You know, the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 3:17, the Lord is spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom in Jesus' mighty name. You may have a seat. You may have a seat. We've got a couple announcements, and we're going to worship more. We're going to worship more here this morning. But we got some things happening here. Again, welcome to New Hope Lihue. For those of you joining us online, it's great to be with you right here in the house of the Lord. Amen. Amen. So men's ministry is happening not this coming Monday, but it's going to happen or starting July 12th. We got some really powerful teaching coming up with Dr. Tony Evans with the rising of the kingdom man. Kingdom man rising is going to be an 8-week process of teaching. And I hope you guys can join us, man. The Lord has some powerful teaching here for the men of Kauai. Amen. Hope to see you guys there July 12th, 6 p.m. right here at our home campus at the Vet Center. Amen. All right, we're looking for volunteers. If you're interested in serving in our wonderful Kids Connection group, we could use your help right here. We got all the different ages happening. Now, if you're like me and you don't think you're qualified, let me tell you what. God is not looking for the qualified. He's looking more for your availability to serve in Jesus' name. And I tell you what, guys, his promise is he's going to bless you even more for doing so. Amen? Amen. All right, let's pray for our tithes and offering. Epulikako, let us pray. Heavenly Father, Daddy, thank you so much, Father. Thank you for this day that we can celebrate you. We can celebrate Independence Day. Father, I truly believe that you were there in that room, in the hearts of the men that decided to go and be an independent of a nation and start the United States of America. Thank you, Lord, that we have the freedom right here, right now, to worship you so freely because of the decisions that you place in the hearts of those men and those women, Father. Will you bless everybody here, Father? Will you open up our hearts to receive your beautiful word today and give us freedom for that? Lord, we love you. We thank you for the gift that you provided this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone says, amen, amen. Hey, guys, church, we got some special guests coming all the way from Kaka'ako Christian Fellowship, all the way from the island of Oahu. They made their way. So will you rise as we worship the Lord? This is Corey and Loki from Kaka'ako Christian Fellowship. Take it away, guys.
Aloha, good morning. God is good. We want to bless you this morning, and we know we are blessed just to be here with you all.
You guys can go ahead and take a seat. This song right here is one of our favorite songs from James Taylor. We know that's not a Christian or worship song, but you know what? I believe that whenever I listen to this song, I hear God saying something, and it's something about counting on His love and humbling ourselves, especially in relationships. And, you know, when we choose to rely on His love, like the song says, something happens and He touches us. He touches the circumstance. He touches the situation and miracles happen. So sometimes He's just waiting for us to choose and surrender and say, God, okay, I count on your love. I rely on you. Take control. And that's what I hear when we sing this song every time. So we hope it blesses you. Thank you for having us, guys.
You can play the game, you can act out the part, even though it wasn't written for you. But tell me, how can you stand there with broken heart, ashamed of playing the fool? One thing can lead to another. It doesn't take any sacrifice. Father and mother, sister and brother, if it feels nice, don't. Shower the people you love with love. Show them the way that you feel. Things are gonna work out fine if you only will.
You can run, but you cannot hide. And this is widely known. Tell me what you plan to do with your foolish pride when you're all by yourself alone. 'Cause once you tell somebody the way that you can feel things beginning to ease. I guess it's true what they say about the squeaky wheel. It's always getting.
Show them the way that you feel.
shower the people you love with love. Show them the way that you feel. Things are gonna be much better if you only will. Shower the people you love with love. Show them.
God, a clap offering in the house of God here today. Can you look at your neighbor and give him a smile, give him a high five, shower them with the love of Christ right now in the house. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Corey and Sloki. Thank you so much. What a blessing. Woo! Just give God another round of applause in the house. Thank you guys so much. Thank you, thank you. What an appropriate song for the series we're doing on Genesis about seeing all that God is doing, right? And that God is showering us and God is showering all of us right here in the house. So thank you so much for these guys being here. What a blessing to be here with us today. How are we doing today, New Hope Lihui? Y'all sound like you're doing pretty good. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Woo, 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 woo. I am excited. I am excited. Man, 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 man. Let me tell you something. Ain't nothing like worship. Can I get an amen? And I give you a message, but we come into some worship. God does something amazing, right? Oh, yes. So all the youth are dismissed to youth class. And it's going to be in the back over there. Look at Pastor Vaughn. You guys get the VIP lounge today. Yes. So for the youth, it's not very important people. It's very interesting people. That was a joke. Only if you got it. So go to VIP Lounge. Hey, listen, Cladle Church. We have been doing a series on Genesis. We started a few weeks ago. We ended last week, beginning to go talk about what's going to happen with Noah. But I felt we wanted to go back today. Look at your neighbor and say, go back. Go back to Genesis 2. And we're going to look at marriages a little more deeply of what is happening here within the scripture. We're going to be doing a word study in this one particular word to help us understand how this should be working within our marriages. Now, I'm going to be honest and transparent with you all here today and those online. This message came about because me and my wife got into an argument. That's right. That's right. And I can talk a bunch of trash here today because Ron is inside teaching the class. So you'll just get my perspective only today. That's it. Just my perspective. No, just joking. I will keep it fair and balanced. That's what I will do. But once again, I want to let you know something. If you are interested in helping out in children's ministry, there is a need. So if you want to help out with the kids' ministry, Kids Connection, please, at the end of the service, go and sign up and become a part of that, of your time, because you'll be blessing them cakey in there. Can I get an amen? But once again, this came about. I was going to begin doing, talking about Noah's going to happen. And the Lord just began to download some things into me. And I thought, you know what? I gotta bring this to the church. And you know, Pastor John, I can only be one way, right? And that's honest and open, transparent and vulnerable. So I'm going to bring the full noise here today to y'all and tell you exactly how this should be broken down. Can I get an amen? you got your Bibles here today, I'll be in Genesis chapter 2. We're going back to chapter 2 here today. Because when we're doing the book of Genesis, we kind of went over this. So I want to get a little bit deeper here today with us here on this 4th of July Sunday. The word of God says in Genesis 2:18, the New Living Translation, it says the following. It says, then the Lord God said, it's not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper who will be just right for him. Look at your neighbor and say, just right. Say, just right. Yeah. Man, if you hear what your wife today, say, you're just right. Say, you're just perfect. You're just what I need. So the Lord God formed from the ground all the wild animals and all the birds of the sky. He brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And the man chose a name for each one of them. He gave names to all the livestock, all the birds of the sky, and all the wild animals. But still, there was no helper just right for him. Look at your neighbor and say, helper, just right for me. If you're a man here in the building, you got a wife next to you, look at her and say, you're just right for me. I want to stop right there for a moment, because I want us to take a look at this word helper. Because we get a deeper meaning of the word helper, we can go through the rest of the text and we can see what is happening and what God's intention was or is for marriages. And how a man and a woman should co-equally be leading their marriage and leading together within their marriage with a sense of equality and a sense of equity within their marriage. But you're only going to get that if you take a look at the word helper. And what does that word helper mean? Today we're going to look at that, then we'll keep on going in the scripture and talk more about what is happening and make this very applicable, if I just pronounced that word correctly, for each and every single one of you. So what does this word mean, helper? Put the next slide up, please, if you could. The word in the Hebrew is ezer. I'll give you a word study today. And ezer means helper. It's the Hebrew word for a helper, is what it means. And this is the word that is used in chapter 2 to describe what a woman is to his man. This is the word that God uses to describe it. And so for us to understand the deeper understanding or perspective of what that word means, then we need to know how that word is being used within Scripture. Does that make sense? That's how you do a Bible study. So, next slide. The word Ezer is used 21 times in the Old Testament. 21 times. Two times it's used to describe the first woman. And after that, it is used three times to tell you how powerful nations are helping Israel. And then it is used 16 times to show that God is being our helper, a helper. It is shown 16 times to show to you and to us that God is our helper. So in some respects, God is saying, this woman is your helper. She is a part of my character, a part of me. I took her from you, but this is who she is. So looking at how it is used in the Bible, where it's used at, let's look at how it's used. Next slide. It refers to Ezer as being a help. So it is a help when you see it used. Or as a savior, as a rescuer, as a protector. As in, God is our help. In other words, Adam, I'm going to send you my help. This is my help to you. This is a person that can help rescue you in circumstances. This is a person who will help you protect you. This is who I am sending. It also refers to being superior or equal. Never is the word Ezer ever used to suggest that a person is a helper or a servant. Never in the Old Testament do you see the word used as if a person is your servant. So what does that tell us about this word? It tells us within the construct of the scriptures that we read concerning women and marriages, they're not meant to do your bidding. They're not meant to be just your servant or do what you want them to do. They are a given help by God. It is a character, a part of God's existence that he is giving to the marriage to make it one. Does that make sense? So this is what we see. So as we read this in the beginning of Scripture, in Genesis 2, we see a deeper definition or understanding of how this marriage or marriages should be working. In other words, I'm not lording over my wife. We do this side by side. She is my ride or die. Can I get an amen? So this is the word Ezra. We see it used and how it's supposed to be used concerning Scripture. So now this changes the game. This changes how we begin to look at things now and how we should be looking at our marriages. So now if I go back and read Scripture to you, after that, we'll begin now on chapter, verse 20. I'm sorry, 21. So the Lord caused the man to fall into a deep sleep, because he's about to give him a helper. While the man slept, the Lord took out one of the man's ribs and closed up the opening. Again, side by side. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib, and he brought her to the man. At last, the man explained, "This is bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She will be called woman because she was taken from me." This explains why a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two become one in marriage. Now the man and his wife were both naked, but they felt no shame. God gave Adam a helper. He didn't give Adam a servant. He didn't give Adam a person to do his bidding or do stuff for him. He gave him a helper. Because let me tell you something. For us men here in the house today, I need a good woman. I need my wife at my side. I'm not complete without my wife. There is something about our relationship that God has put together and the equality of it. So what does that mean? That means that within the construct of your marriages here, we need to have an understanding that I'm not here to lord over my woman. I'm here to work side by side with her. But sometimes we mess those things up. So let me get deep with y'all and vulnerable. This message here came about because me and Rhonda got into an argument. We got into an argument over cooking. Rhonda says, "Hey, I'm tired of cooking. It's tiring." And we get this big argument, and I get offended by it. We get this big argument over who's doing this and that. And the Lord began to realize something in this. You see, within your marriage, there is leadership happening. There is a man's leadership and a woman's leadership. And it is shared leadership that is coming together to work together for your marriage. So in saying that, we need to have an understanding that the woman might have a need. So when she expresses a need, she is expressing a part of leadership that needs to be expressed within the marriage. We as men can't find ourselves getting offended or upset when she expresses something that needs to be done. Because it has to get done. And she's expressing a shared leadership within the marriage. There's a sense of equality, a sense of equilibrium that is happening within the construct of their marriage or your marriage. So what happens? An expressed need within marriage is leadership. So if there was something that needed to be done, a leader would get it done, correct? If there is something within your marriage that needs to be get done, and the woman expresses, "Hey, I have a need, this needs to be done," she's expressing, in some respects, leadership. But sometimes men get a hard time with that. Because we can feel that, well, she's got to be the helper. She's supposed to know. She's expressing a leadership. Which means at that moment within our marriages, at times, as a man, you kind of come under that leadership. Hey, I need some help. With what? I need some help with the budget. I need some help with the housework. I need some help with these kids. I have a need. I'm expressing you my need. Because she sees a need. because she loves you so much and loves this marriage so much, she is willing to take ownership and leadership of something that needs to be done. Can you help out to get this done? But sometimes we as men get insecure. Oh, what you mean? I'm a boss, you know. I'm not doing that. You know, and we get all uptight about that. Well, I need help with the budget. What you saying? I don't provide enough money. No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying that I need some help planning our monthly budget. Can you come alongside and help me do that? Oh, I don't know, guy. I don't know. She has a need. So many times what happens if in our marriages, myself included, is the woman has kind of began to be a help as God has made her a help. And she is seeing something the man's not seeing, and she's expressing the need for the marriage. I'm concerned about our kids. I'm concerned that our son might be doing something. Can you spend more time with him? Instead of getting offended or feeling threatened by that, she asks you something, you say, oh, okay, I get it. I'm going to do that. But now here's where we kind of blow it sometimes. When the woman expresses the need is how she expresses it. And that's the issue. So, you can't express a need if you're holding on to a bunch of assumptions. See, mostly women, you assume the man knows. You assume the man should know that you should be helping me with some of this cooking. Right? And that's around what's happened to us, right? There's this assumption that you should just know. Women, the man don't know. Now, you know, don't get all excited. I'll come back to you in a second. I get you. The man don't know, right? So that's what happens. We're going to be like, you know, he should know. He should know that I'm cooking dinner every night for these kids. And I shouldn't have to tell him. How many times you ladies said that? I shouldn't have to tell him. He should know. Let me tell you something, brother. He don't know. He has no idea. He's clueless. He is clueless that you're cooking every night. He is clueless. Maybe if I would ask some men in the house here today, hey, what bill is due next week? I don't know. I got no idea. And he don't know. And that's a fear. So he don't know. And it's a natural fear of his. So when you express to him in a way that's disrespectful, right, he's going to get defensive because it's a fear. Ladies and gentlemen, all your arguments over fear. Every argument you get into as a marriage, deep inside for that one person, there's a fear that's causing you to react that way. So I need help with the budget. You can help me. He gets to, because he doesn't know how to do it. So how you express the need is really, really, really important. So you express the need in a manner that is respectful of the man. Hey, babe, yes, I'd really appreciate if I can get some help with the cooking. Oh, now in my house, that's not what happened. Mom was just like, she was just like, you know, I'm tired of cooking every night for these kids. And I was like, okay, I'm sorry. I apologize. And I'm a mess. So I'm thinking, oh man, Ron is wonderful. I mean, I'm in the master's program and she's doing the cooking. Well, she's amazing. Yeah, she was amazing for a point. But after a while, she said, I'm getting tired. I got a need. So I said, babe, you know what? I didn't know that was a need. And she never said, well, you should have known. But we realized that there was an issue. Because Rhonda is not that, she's not the helper that we think she is. She isn't equal with me. Does that make sense? We do this together. In your marriage, you do it together. You have to express women the need. Now, here's the thing, men. Don't get defensive or insecure when the woman comes to you with a need. And that's what happens. We get defensive. We get insecure. Because most of our lives, we've been taught that a woman's position is here. So therefore, she must always respect and honor everything I say and do. But there are times within your marriage where a woman might say, you know what? What you're doing ain't right. And if you ain't got a woman who can step into you that way, something's wrong in your marriage. If a woman can't step into her man and say, you know what? There's an issue right here. Something's wrong. This ain't proper, right? She is showing she loves you enough to lead you enough. And the same thing with the man also, right? Because we do this what? We do this equally. It's done together, right? It's not one or the other. We do this together. So what does that look like? Within your marriage, you have needs. There are things that need to be done within your marriage. For your kids, for work, different things got to happen. So there are times within your marriage that the man, he might take sole leadership. But there might be a time when them bills got to get done. And guess who takes leadership? Woman comes in, she's doing it. And if she needs a need, you can say, I need a need. You're going to come alongside her. The man goes forward. He needs a need within the house. Also within work also. Hand me that bottle right there. Do it before. You got it, girl. That's it. No. That's it. That's my, yeah. Give a round of applause to my daughter-in-law. Thank you, girl. So Ron and I, for years, we did a business together. We made pasteles for years and years and years. I can't tell you how many arguments we got into on how to wrap a pastele. How you wrap this thing? And back and forth and back and forth, right? And let me tell you something. If you ever came to watch us do food together, you would probably think we was going to kill each other. Someone came to me once and said, I'm amazed you guys are still married. I said, hey, that's how it is. Because stuff got to get done. I can't be offended if Ron is yelling at me, I need an order. I can't be like, well, I'm a man. You can't talk to me that way. That's the customer. They want their food. I need you to hurry up. Watch who you're talking to, woman. Don't ever say that. The point I'm making is that you do life together. Things get different. It is co-partnership. There is equality within that marriage. Within your marriage, if you're not spending once in a while but talking debrief about some things, every time we finish doing our stuff, we would debrief and say, how'd it go? We needed this, we needed that. Because we knew that something greater was at stake within our business, and it was our marriage. Within my ministry, there's something greater at stake besides this ministry. It is my marriage. We do this together. We do this with equality. You understand? Let me tell you something. This church wouldn't be what it is today without my wife. Plain and simple. So it's important that within our marriages we understand that it's the word helper or ezer, not to be as a servant, to be obedient to everything that you say. That woman has some things to say. That man has some things to say. We can't be insecure, lording over each other. We do this together. God said, I'm going to find you the perfect helper. Which means that within your marriage, if you're here today and you're contemplating, let us say this, let's make believe. If that was a real pastel, I'd be jumping on that thing right now. Within your marriages and those getting married, you find the right one. You find the one that is perfect for you to be your helper. And within your marriage, if things ain't working out, you got to fix some things. You make sure that you begin to fix some things within your marriage with the understanding that we do this together. Right? If there are issues within the marriage, and the woman says, hey, we got some issues. Or the man says, I'm concerned about a few things. You better come together as one to fix that. In equity and equality for each other. For your marriage and for the love of each other. Can I get an amen? This word Ezer is really, really important for us to grasp and to understand. So it's shared leadership within your marriage. Leadership is shared. Well, how is that, Pastor John? I'll tell you why. Because God is in covenant with you. You in covenant with your wife or your husband. In the covenant God has with you, God is sharing with you leadership. Because last I checked, he said, go out to all the world and make disciples. He has entrusted you with something, each of us, to love God and love people. So God, from his position, is sharing with each of us as Christians a form of leadership to reach the world. And that same covenant relationship is no different within your marriages here today. It is a shared leadership responsibility. Now, how you work that in your marriage is up to you. Maybe you want to do all the cooking, that's fine. I get it. But there better be some conversations about some needs that we have happening here within our marriages. Because if we don't have that, make these assumptions, you'll blow it up. And that's what happens. We just assume, hey, it's the way it's supposed to be. That's how it's supposed to go. But God has covenant with you, covenant within your relationship. The leadership is shared. We see this from the beginning of Scripture in the book of Genesis. Let me tell the husband something here today. If you can't receive that, if your husband in the house here today, and you get defensive, or you get insecure, when your wife might express a need for the marriage, whether it be your bills, your business, and you have a hard time with that, can I tell you something? It's poor leadership. It's a misrepresentation of God's character within your marriage. And I will guarantee you this. If you do it in your marriage, you'll do it elsewhere also. That's the foundation. For the construct of our marriages here today, it is a shared leadership responsibility. Now, am I saying the man is the head of household? No, he's head of household because he's strong. I get that. But here's the thing. Thank you, Lord. Look carefully at Scripture. The man had a choice. The man could have chose the animals, or he could have chose the woman. The man said, these animals ain't working for me. This is not my help. And God said, I give you a woman that he named, flesh of your flesh. Today, men, you make the right choice. What do you choose? You choose that woman at your side to lead alongside you. Well, sometimes we go back to this mindset of, well, she's just an animal to be, you know, to serve me in a certain way. It's a choice that we make. And to be honest with you, it's a choice that sometimes we mess up. That we mess up. Let's not mess it up. Make your marriage strong. How do you make them strong? Between the dignity of both husband and wife coming together as one. Amen? So husbands, don't catch feelings. Don't get offended. Don't get defensive. She loved you enough to lead you enough. It's okay to be a follower sometimes. I don't mind following my wife's lead sometimes. I've got to follow her lead. I don't know what to do. Okay. I got it. And women, be respectful of your men. Respect them and honor them. A lot of times a man's afraid to tell you he doesn't know. Which leads to the scripture that says they were both naked, had no shame. Within your marriages, there should be no secrets. You should be vulnerable and transparent. You should be able to stand in front of your husband or your wife fully naked and not afraid. And when I say naked, I don't mean clothes naked. I mean heart naked and soul naked. These are my fears. The fact of the matter is, I'm scared to do bills. The fact of the matter is, I get insecure sometimes because how I was raised. These are the real issues on the table. If you can't put those on the table in your marriage, you're in a bad spot. Because we see here from the beginning of Scripture what God was putting together. God was saying, you do this equally. So equally means I know your fears, you know my fears, we know everything about each other. Are you ready? Let's go. Let's go do this together as one. This is what marriage was meant to be. But over years, even scripturally also, and we learned last week, we see with Lamech, right? Lamech did what? How many wives did he have? He got two wives, right? So seven generations after this, we're going to see now men, I want more than, one's not enough, I want more. That's what happens sometimes, you mess things up. So we have a choice. What are you going to choose within your marriage? You're going to choose God's best of what he's given you, or you're going to choose to try to find something else to help you. It's that simple. Choose your help. And we see this kind of thing even happening from the church construct. I'll be very honest with you here today. Right? So if in churches also, we saw theologies come out in the 1980s and 70s talking about, you know, that meant to compliment and puts a woman in her place. I don't agree with that. I'll tell you right now as your pastor. So we give these titles of submission to women sometimes. We see it even in church. I know it's sometimes going across as being honoring, but we do this. We say, hey, that's the pastor's wife. Wonderful, honoring. But you name me any other place where you would go and say, that's the plumber's wife. Where would you say that's the electrician's wife? Name me any other place where you would give the title of the man before the woman. Well, if in churches we do this sometimes, and I understand it's honoring, but it's also relegating that person, right, to a position. The fact of the matter is, for me, that's my wife, I get that. You can say, she's a pastor, I get it. But here's the bottom line. This church wouldn't be what it is if not for my wife. In other words, her leadership is not just relegated to just being my wife. She don't need my title. She has her own title. Does it make sense? And we do this sometimes. So we say that that's the pastor. That, you know, they might be good enough to do with children, different things they're doing. But can we really raise women up to leadership? So when we say this collectively, what are we saying to women? What I was saying, proposed to you, was saying that you are in a certain position. If that's the pastor's wife, what is your position then? Well, you're just your husband's wife. No, that woman could be a leader. She can raise herself to any standard she wants to raise herself to. And let me tell you something here within this church. I don't base leaders on gender. I base them on who can get the job done. It's like NFL draft, and I'm on the board. I want to draft the best player, the best person, right? We shouldn't relegate our women to positions. They are qualified to lead. And you see from the beginning of the book of Genesis, their qualification to lead and to lead alongside a man and to be alongside a man. I'm a better man for it. Can I get an amen? So we see in Genesis 2, we see what God is doing. And we'll keep on going as we go to the book of Genesis. We'll see how we end up messing this thing up. We end up just kind of, you know, blowing it. And most of us blow it, male and female, because, hey, we make assumptions, right? We get insecure. We get defensive. We get scared. We don't know what to do. But God's intention for our marriages here today was to lead equally within your marriage, not to have one lord over another. In fact, Christ even said, not with you. Don't lord over each other. It's the kind of leadership that God expressed. It's the kind of leadership that is also within our marriages here today. Scripture says something also I want to point out to you. It says, this explains why a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one. There's a lot happening there. So into one shows a physical bond of oneness and a spiritual bond of oneness. Let me tell you all here today, you can't enter into something without permission, and you can't allow something in without permission. In other words, for your marriages and those, we mess this up within society because we, honestly, we can sometimes have sex outside of marriage. So we've allowed someone to enter without permission, right? And we allowed to enter without permission, without God's permission. In other words, keep it real before God. Keep it honoring before God. For those here who are single and looking to get married, you wait for the right one. You don't let nothing enter without permission. For you who are male and you want to enter, you can't enter without permission. And ultimately, you need God's permission. Can I get it? Amen. Wait for the right one. Because scripturally, the helper will be the perfect one that you will need. Amen? I'm going to ask the praise and worship band to come up here and finish this thing out. Without the woman, the man is half the story. Within your marriage, the man is half the story without the woman. There are times within your marriage where you know that you need that woman's wisdom. There are times when you need to know or hear something from her. Hey, can I get your perspective? What do you think about this? And the same thing for the women also. We do this equally. Even within this church here, Ezra is a helper. Ezra is a savior. Ezra is a rescuer. Ezra is a protector. Ezra is, and God is our help. Thank God that God saw it fit to make man and a woman to help each other. And what does the devil always come after? What does he always break up? Marriages. What does the enemy try to foundationally tear apart? Marriages. Where do young men and young women all busted up come out of? Broken marriages. I was one of them. The enemy knows. If I can sneak in here and make you think differently of God's intent, of what God is doing here, within your marriage, I can blow everything up. If I can make a man insecure about his own leadership, I can blow this thing up. If I can make a woman think that she's more than she's supposed to be for the marriage, I can blow this thing up. If I can make them think, the enemy says, that they're not meant to lead equally together, if I can make them think otherwise, I can blow this thing up. And that's what the enemy has done. Interesting that the next chapter, the enemy comes in. We talked about that a few weeks ago. Think about this closely, saints. Think about that word, helper, Ezra. For you men in the building tonight, look at your wife and realize that God sent you a good woman. You blessed. And there may be times where she might have to take the lead. Maybe tell you a few things or teach you a few things. Don't be insecure in that. Ladies, don't make assumptions. Respect your man. Talk to him out that he understands. Talk to his fears. It's okay. For those here today, express to your husband and your wife. Express those fears, your challenges, the deepness inside of you. It's okay. Let me tell you something. God will take you places your marriage will never get otherwise. Because that's the intention from chapter 2 in the book of Genesis. The book of Ephesians, to sum this up, chapter 5, verse 21 says this. This is Paul speaking about marriage. He says, and further, he says, submit to one another. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Out of reverence for Christ. When we come together in our marriages, out of reverence to Christ, and this is a God who is superior, and his superiority, he is allowing us to share in his glory in reaching the world. We in our marriages here today, those who are married, those about to be married, understand this is done for sense of equity. We come side by side. You express your need, I express my need, and we move forward with the Lord. And most of all, husbands and wives, what you need is Jesus. That is your head. That is your everything. And if each of you have enough of Jesus, each will be enough for each other. Can I get an amen? Let us pray here in the house. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for today's word. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are our help, that you care for us. We ask you in Jesus' name to be with us here, to be with our marriages. If there's anybody in the house today and you don't know Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, I want to give you that opportunity as we do every single Sunday to receive him. This message spoke to your heart here today. Spoke to your marriage here today. Why don't you repeat the prayer with us also? If you want to rededicate your life to the Lord, this prayer is for you also. If we can, as a collective church, together, all of us, please repeat this prayer after me. Say, Dear Jesus, come into my heart. I receive you now as my Lord and Savior. I believe that you died for me and my sins are forgiven. I am a new creation in Christ Jesus. Amen. If you said that prayer here today, the Bible declares you're a new believer in Jesus Christ. If you said that prayer to rededicate yourself or your marriage is back to God, we love you. Happy you're here. Amen. Let us rise to our feet and worship him because he's more than enough.
Going through a storm, but I won't go down. I hear your voice carrying the rhythm of the wind to calm me down. You cross an ocean so I wouldn't drown. You've never been closer than you are right now.
Husband, look at them and say, you're more than enough. Say, you're more than enough. Say, you're more than enough because God is more than enough. Say, you're more than enough because I'm not looking at anything else but God and you. You're more than enough. I love you and I value you. I value our collective leadership and what God is doing within our marriage. I value God's word so much. So I put God's word into account in our lives to lead accordingly. Amen? Hey, listen up, church. A few quick announcements. Men, Sign up in the back for that. Tony, you haven't studied. It is going to be amazing. Sign up's in the back. If you need prayer here today, folks will pray for you in the back. If you made a decision for Christ here today, or if you rededicated your life here today before the Lord, we got a Bible for you in the back. We want to get you connected. Amen? And finally, today, we are going to be partially breaking down the church. So we'll need help with some of these chairs, if you don't mind. Just maybe put a few chairs on our racks. Amen? Listen, God loves you. God cares for you. We have four important values here at New Hope Lihue. Love, acceptance, forgiveness, and hope. And there's no greater place but to put those marriages together within, put that together within your marriages. Amen? We love you. God bless you. Have a great week in the Lord. Aloha.